I'm giving this presentation on behalf of Keith Smith, who's had a problem with his microphone. From 1815, when practical marine steam engines first appeared, until the perfection of the screw propeller in the 1840s, the only means of propulsion for steamships was the paddle wheel. The advantages of steam power quickly became obvious, and it was taken up for commercial use on rivers and coastal trade routes. For instance, by 1817, there was a regular service from London to Margate, which continued until the end of the Second World War. Now, for a number of reasons, the Admiralty was cautious in committing themselves totally to this new method of propulsion. The engines and boilers were still inefficient and needed constant maintenance and repair. They were also very heavy, and with the coal bunkers took up to a third of the ship's capacity, restricting the number of broadside guns. The paddles in the crankshaft were also high above the waterline and very, very vulnerable to shell fire. Now, during the early years, therefore, the Navy, whilst encouraging design and development, only used paddle steamers in auxiliary roles, although these became increasingly important. They were used to tow sailing battleships in and out of harbour and to manoeuvre them into position to bombard shore installations. They also played an important part in amphibious operations, transporting and landing troops. By 1835, there were only 20 or so paddle steamships in the naval service. However, by this time, engine development had progressed sufficiently for the Navy to begin to build true paddle warships in the form of sloops and frigates. Around 60 of these were built in all, and by 1850, the screw had been developed and engines redesigned to be contained below the waterline, where they did not restrict the space for broadside guns. Now, as you probably know, the efficiency of screws over paddles was demonstrated in 1845 with a tug of war between the screw-driven sloop Rattler and the paddle-driven sloop Alecto. With both ships' sterns connected together with a cable and both under full power, Rattler towed Alecto backwards at 2.7 knots. Paddle-driven warships therefore became obsolete and construction stopped. The last one, Valorous, was launched in 1852. Now, Dragon was built in Pembroke Dock and launched in 1845. Her engines were fitted in the East India Dock on the Thames in London. She was completed in May 1847, and her career only lasted for 18 years. She was broken up in 1865. However, this was an era of experiment and development, and during her short life, she underwent a series of refits and upgrading. At the beginning, the Navy had a problem in the classification of paddle warships. At launch, they were mostly brig-rigged because the central position of the engines and coal bunkers prevented sighting the masts in their usual positions. They were, however, too large to be classified as sloops, and also they were commanded by post captains, so they were rated as frigates, either first or second class. I decided to model Dragon and her engines because I found that the National Maritime Museum's plans collection had a set of as-built drawings of the ship, and more important, an extract from the publication The Engineer and Machinist's Assistant, entitled Direction Action Engines of HM Steam Frigate Dragon. Now, this contained detailed descriptions of every moving part and fully detailed drawings of the engines. There was also a drawing from the Sheerness Dockyard showing the method used to lay out the copper sheets below the waterline. The only thing missing was any details of the figurehead, so I'm afraid I had to use my imagination there. The ship and the engines are shown as they were at the completion in 1847, but quite soon after this, things changed. A mizzen mast was added in the stern so she became a full-rigged ship with three masts. Now, both models are to a scale of 1 to 96 and are shown on the same baseboard. First, I will talk about the ship. The hull was constructed in lime, with the forward and stern sections hollowed out. The upper deck beams are shown over these areas, and some of the planking is omitted to show the fitting out of the main deck. There were extra heavy beams in the area of the engines and diagonal frames to stiffen the hull against vibrations. There are many small metal parts on this model, especially in the engines. I decided to have these made using photo-etched brass. I made drawings of each item at twice the finished scale, and the photography and etching were carried out by a professional firm who are called Photo Echo Consultants Limited of Walsall. The forward part of Dragon's main deck was provided with gun ports, and the as-fitted drawings show rings for the breaching ropes. However, the guns were never fitted. The reason for this is uncertain and may have been because one of her primary roles was to act as a troop carrier. This deck was therefore fitted out with tables and rifle racks. When the port lids were closed, light was provided by circular glass portholes set into the port lids. The central part of the main deck was occupied by the upper part of the engines and coal bunkers, and there was no passageway on this level between the fore and aft parts of the ship. Now, the after section of the main deck was occupied by the officers' cabins, with a spacious cabin in the stern for the captain, although he did have to share it with the rudderhead. And there were no guns on this level. All the cabins were permanent structures. The upper deck was level from stem to stern. All the bulwarks, which were divided into sections, could be hinged down or completely removed. This allowed a completely free field of fire for her guns, which were all on this deck. They are stored along the centre line of the ship and moved to their firing positions on tracks called racers. On the model, these are etched brass. Now, this slide shows one of the guns in its firing position. Note the massive bollards. There are three sets of these, two in the bow area, two by the sponsons, and two in the stern, which emphasise her towing role. Now, Dragon only carried six guns, but they were large caliper weapons. There is a 68-pounder, 9,500-weight gun in the bow and a similar-sized weapon in the stern. And these were the last of the cast-iron smoothbore muzzle-loading guns, and they were very successful. Then there were two 10-inch shell-firing guns in both bow and stern. The gun carriages no longer had trucks. They were mounted on metal covered wood slides with rollers front and back, which linked up with the racers. On the model, the barrels are in brass, turned on a lathe, fitting such as the adjustable compressors, which clamp the carriage to the slide, are etched in brass. Now, on completion of Dragon, she carried these two cutters. They have been modelled in plastic card on a mould in the usual way. The most impressive items on the upper deck are the two paddle wheel sponsons. A large boat was stored upside down on the top of each of them, and the revolving paddle wheels penetrated into the boats, whose thwarts were removed until needed. This stopped them drying out. The boats were for troop transportation. They were large and heavily built, holding up to 100 men. Because the sponsons were well above the deck level, they were used by lookouts and perhaps for conning the ship into harbour. So there were ladders up to the top of the upturned boats and a demountable handrail fixed to the boat's keel. Now, the starboard boat on the model is shown being lowered by a complicated arrangement of davits. Both sponsons are extended fore and aft of the paddle wheels and contain on the port side the crew's heads and the signals room for the storing of flags. The starboard sponson holds the galley, chimney can be seen, and the cook's cabin. The group of hatches and skylights between the sponsons give light and ventilation to the engine room. The two built-up sections cover the two cranks in the crankshaft, which revolve above deck level. Now, I will talk a bit about the engines. On the model, these are made up of timber, plastic, photo-etched brass, copper, and stainless steel. Early steam marine engines were side lever or beam engines, but by 1847, a very different type had been developed, direct action engines, which became more or less universal in the Navy. Side lever engines continued to be used on commercial vessels, however, as John showed last month in the Scotia launched in the 1860s. Direct action engines, as their name implies, connect power from the cylinders directly to the crankshaft via a connecting rod, without the complication of transmission. First through a side lever, this has a number of advantages. The space in the vessel occupied by the engines is greatly reduced, and its weight by up to one third. Dragon's engines were built by William Fairbairn and Sons in London. They were called engines, plural, because they had two cylinders, each of which had independent controls, although both were connected to a common crankshaft, so that the two paddle wheels could not be used independently to manoeuvre the ship. The engines developed 560 nominal horsepower, and on trials, Dragon achieved a speed of 11.5 knots. The paddles were 27 feet in diameter, and each paddle had three frames. On the model, each frame was built up with several pieces of photo-etched brass to give depth to the framing. Now, each paddle board was split into two narrow strips, set step-like around the rim. The intention seems to have been to reduce the shock and loss of power of a wide board striking the water. There were 64 boards on each paddle. When the ship was going to travel under sails alone, the paddles caused a lot of drag, so members of the crew had to enter the sponsons and remove the section of the boards that were underwater, a difficult and dangerous operation for which they were given extra rum. The framework of the engines is painted green and is held rigid in the ship by heavy timber crossbeams, not shown on the model. Two engineers operated the engines from the checker plate platform at the forward end of the engines, level with the top of the condensers. Each cylinder was controlled by a 6 feet diameter starting wheel and several levers. Finally, there were three boilers of the tubular type fired by seven furnaces, producing a steam pressure of 8 to 10 pounds per square inch. During her life, Dragon had a great deal of trouble with her engines, in particular her boilers, and these had to be replaced in 1852. So by the mid-1860s, the era of the paddle frigate was over, and although a few survived until the end of the century, they were used mainly as auxiliaries. Now, these ships have an important place in naval history. However, as their era spanned the change between the sailing navy of Nelson's day and the coming of the propeller, steel, and the ironclad,